Hello everyone, today we will start a new series on graph neural networks. So we will see how graphs can be implemented using neural networks. So for that I have two pictures over here to give you a high level understanding of how we will incorporate graphs with neural networks. So basically here you can see it's a typical graph structure with nodes here and the edges connecting these nodes. So it's a typical graph that you will find in literature. And this you already know is basically a neural network. So it has two hidden layers, input layer and the corresponding output layer. So this particular lecture series, which basically deals with graph neural network, is how to interact or how to feed this into this particular neural network. And the area which actually deals with the interaction of graph and neural network is also called as geometric deep learning. So this is basically the area that we will discuss in a little details and see how we can motivate our listeners to work in this area of geometric deep learning. So what is geometric deep learning? Geometric deep learning is basically how to feed graphs into neural networks and come up with the decision rule as we were doing in case of a typical neural networks. Our lectures in graph neural network will be divided in three different subtopics. In the first topic, what we will do is we will understand the basic theory of graphs. By saying basic theory of graphs means we will understand what are the basic terminologies that are required in order to understand the graph theory. And then we will discuss how we can implement the graphs using neural networks. And this is basically published in 2017, which is very recently, by Thomas Kipf. I will provide the link of this paper in the description section of our video. So basically we will try to understand how this author has implemented graphs using neural networks. And once it is done, we will then implement this graph neural networks using TensorFlow or Keras and see how we can perform classification task on graphs. So these are the topics that we will discuss in details. So in order to start our lecture, let's discuss first of all the fundamentals of graph theory. And once that is over, then we will move forward to graph neural networks. So let's move to the next slide. So before going further, let's define what is graphs. So basically graphs are a structured data type that has nodes and edges. You can see there are two different types of graphs. This is basically called as nodes of the graph. These are nodes, and the link that is connecting these two nodes are called as edges. So in this particular example, we have four nodes and four edges. Whereas in this case, we have five nodes, this one. So these are the five nodes, and how many edges? Four edges, as indicated by black lines. So graphs are basically structured data types that has nodes and edges, as you can see over here. So there are two types of graphs. One is directed graph, another one is called as undirected graphs. So directed graphs are defined in this way, where we have incorporated the direction in the edges that are connecting these two nodes. So as you can see that the direction of the edge is this side. And in this case, the direction of the edge is this side. So there is a direction involved in the edges. So it's basically called as the directed graph. A practical example of this directed edges graph is Twitter, which is shown over here also. So the network of Twitter is directed because when you follow somebody on Twitter, it doesn't mean that that person who you have followed will follow you. So it's in some sense directed. So what you are doing is you are following that person, but it doesn't mean that that person will follow you. So it's only in one direction. So that's why it's the request or the following in Twitter is directed graph. Whereas in case of this particular graph, which we are calling as undirected, there is no direction given to the edges. As you can see, there is no direction present between the nodes. So it's both the directions. So a practical example for undirected graph is Facebook friend request. When you make a friend request to your friend on Facebook, and if your friend accepts it, then you both will become friends, and then you both can see the content of each other on Facebook profiles. So that is a good example of undirected graphs. So these are the two types of graphs that you will see in graph literature, that is directed and undirected. And one of the important things in graph is that we can have labels on both the edges and nodes. And the labels can be of different types. This example shows that we have numerical labels, as you can see over here. The nodes are given by numerical labels as 1, 6, 7 and 3. And also the edges are given the numerical weights, which are given as 16, 13, 1 and 2. So these are the labels that are given to the edges and nodes, and the type of these labels are numerical. And it doesn't mean that it always has to be numerical. They can be textual labels also, as can be seen over here. In this case, here you can see we have textual labels, which are C, B and A given to the nodes, and dark and light given to the edges. So this is a typical example of textual labels. Some other variations of these labels are that it doesn't mean that all the labels have to be different. They can be unique also. For example, in this case, here you can see the chemical compound NO2, which we have represented in terms of a graph. So what you observe here is that a label of N is given to this node, but O and O are given to these two nodes. So the labels are unique here. It doesn't mean that the labels have to be different. They can be unique, as you can see over here. And same goes with the labels on the edges. They can also be unique, as in this case. Another important thing that is to be kept in mind is node features. So what are they? So as you can see, this is the same graph that we are representing over here. But along with this, we have this feature vectors that represent this particular node. As you can see, we have this set of features that represent this particular node, and this set of features that represent this particular node. And the features are, like, for example, O, which has 6 valence electrons, is one of the features. It's a non-metal, is again one of the features of O, and the atomic number is 8, is again one of the features of this O. And since this O and this O are same, the feature vectors for these two are same. Whereas in case of nitrogen, we have 5 valence electrons and it's a non-metal and its atomic number is 7. So this feature vector is basically representing this particular node N over here. So all these feature vectors are of size 3 cross 1. So this is also one of the important features of graph. One of the things that has to be kept in mind is, please do not mix labels with features. That is, do not mix these labels which are provided over the edges or the nodes with these features. An analogy for this is that a node can be represented as a person. A node label is basically person's name, and the features that you are representing for that node are actually indicating the person's characteristics. So what it is trying to say is that, so this node is basically the person, this N is the person's name, and these features that are actually representing this person are basically the characteristics of this person. So the next important thing is how to convert these graphs in a format that the computer can accept. That is one of the most important things, because we can make graphs on papers, but it is important to how to feed these graphs into computers. So it has to be somehow converted into some numerical format. So for that case, we have some matrices defined for these graphs. So the very first matrix that we are interested in defining is what we call as incidence matrix. What is this? It's basically a matrix of size N cross M, which is important. Please note that it is very important, where N are the number of nodes and M are the edges of the graph. So rows are basically the nodes and M are basically the edges. So for example, if you see here, we have one typical example. We have this graph with 4 nodes and 4 edges. So if that is the case, as you can see that these are the nodes 1, 2 and 3 and 4 and 3, and these are the edges, which are E1, E3, E2 and E1. So what we will do is we will represent it in the form of a matrix, which is given over here. So as you know that N is basically the number of nodes, which represents the rows of this matrix. So these are the number of, so there will be 4 rows as indicated by the node numbering here. And again, we have 4 edges, which are represented over here as columns. So M is equal to 4 here and N is equal to 4 here. So how to fill the entries of this matrix? It is very simple. So the entry will be 1 if node and edge are incident. That is, they are related. By incident means related. So if the node and edge are related, then it will be 1, otherwise it will be 0. So for example, when we will look at node 1 and its corresponding edge E1, So you can see that this E1 is related to this node 1. So that's why we are putting it as value 1 over here. Again, when we will look at node 1 and E2. So here you can see that 1 is connected to E2 with this. So again, you have 1 over here. In case of E3, node 1 is connected to E3 also. So it is 1 over here also. But there is no connection of node 1 with E4. This E4 is not connected with 1. So we have 0 over here. So let's take any arbitrary point like this one and this one. So let's see whether node 3 has edge E3 connected or not. So the edge E3 is connected to node 3 or not? No, it is not connected. That's why we keep it as 0 over here. So we can fill these entries with the same rule as given over here. So it will be 1 if the edge and the nodes are related, and it will be 0 if they are not related at all. So again, this is an example of undirected graph. By saying undirected graph means there is no arrows pointing out in either of the directions on edges. That's why it's called as undirected graph. So it's an incidence matrix on undirected graph. So this is the same concept, that is writing an incidence matrix for the directed graph. But the only difference is that if the edge is moving out of the node, then the value will be plus 1. And if the edge is moving into the node, then its value will be given as minus 1. So based on that concept, you can write this incidence matrix easily. Please check and verify whether this is true or not. So this is the case of writing incidence matrix for directed graphs. So the next concept is called as adjacency matrix A. It is also called as connection matrix, which is a square matrix. Please note, it's a square matrix, and the component of the matrix are either 0 or 1. So it's a binary matrix depending upon whether the nodes of the graph are adjacent or not. That is important. So for example, since it's a square matrix and it's related to the nodes, so you can expect that the rows will be the nodes and the columns will also be the nodes. In the earlier case, nodes were here and the edges were this side, and it's not a square matrix. Whereas in this case, it's a square matrix because both the sides, that is the rows and the columns, will both be nodes. And how we will fill this entry? The entry will be filled by either 0 or 1 depending upon whether the nodes are adjacent or not. So here in this case, you can see P1 and P1 entry is of no relevance. So we will put it as 0. And same will go for P2, P2, P3, P3, P4, P4 and P5, P5. So the diagonals of these matrix will all be 0 because there is no relevance in P1, P1 and P2, P2, P3 and P3 and P4, P4 pairs. This is P4. But how P1 and P2 are connected? Yeah, they are connected. So we will put the value of 1 over here. P1 and P3 is connected? No. So it will be 0. Similarly, you can fill all the other entries like this. So this adjacency matrix will give you, how nodes are connected to the nearby nodes. So it's basically giving you information about the neighborhood of this particular node P1 or P2 or P3, P4 or P5. So it's basically collecting the neighborhoods of each node. So this matrix is giving you information about the neighborhoods of a particular node. So this is very important, and we will be using it in our understanding when we will go for the derivation of graph neural networks. And another point to be noted here is that the adjacency matrix can be weighted also, which means that edge has an associated value. So instead of 1, at that point we will put the value in the respective matrix coordinate. So what does it mean is, for example, if it is a weighted matrix with a value of 8, so what we will do is we will connect P1 and P2 with the edge of 8. So instead of writing 1 over here, what we will write is 8 if it is a weighted matrix. And similarly, when P2 is linked with P1, so this will also be replaced by 8. So if other edges are also weighted by, let us say, 7, 5, 3, so you have to change all these matrix coefficients accordingly with the values of 7, 5 and 3 and see where it will be changed. So this is basically the concept of adjacency matrix when weights of the edges are also given. The next concept is basically the degree matrix. That is also very important. So in the degree matrix D, what is that? It's a diagonal matrix which contains information about the degree of each node. By saying degree of each node means that is how many number of edges are attached to that each node. So as you can see, since it is always related to the node information, so it will also be a square matrix. That is important. So the rows and the columns both will be nodes. And now how you will fill the entries? You have to fill the entries by seeing that one is connected to one by how many edges. So how many edges are connected to node 1? So one is this one, and two we will count for the self loop. So it's a 4 value over here. Now how many edges are connected to node 2? So there are 1, 2 and 3. So 3 are there. So 3 edges are connected to nodes 2. So that's why we are writing 3 over here. Similarly, you can go for, let us say 6. How many edges are connected to 6? Only 1. So that's why we have 1 over here. So we will fill these entries in a diagonal fashion for the degree matrix, and the rest of the values over here and over here will all be 0. So it's a diagonal matrix. Please note this is a diagonal matrix. The next important concept which will be used extensively in understanding the literature of graph neural network is Laplacian matrix, which is also called as graph Laplacian. So that is basically defined by L, and it is the difference of the degree matrix minus the adjacency matrix. And please note, it is also called as Laplace-Beltrami operator, which is basically the measure of smoothness of a vertex, that is how quickly it changes between the adjacent vertex. So this operator is actually telling you how smooth the graph is. So this finishes off with the basic understanding of graph theory and the related terminologies that are involved in converting these graphs into matrices, which are incidence matrix, adjacency matrix and Laplacian matrix. So basically these matrices will be used by the computer to manipulate the graphs. So once we have clear understanding of all these terminologies, in the next lecture what we will discuss is we will implement graphs using neural networks. And so till then, thanks for watching my lecture. See you next time.